So in his remaining time in office, Biden says he's going to move forward with his major initiative to control the court. And his replacement in the presidential race, Kamala Harris, is already making the Supreme Court a key part of her campaign. Here she is just last week.
You know, when he was president, Donald Trump, former president, handpicked three members of the United States Supreme Court because he intended for them to overturn Roe v. Wade. The United States Supreme Court, previously the court of Thurgood and RBG. And as he intended, they did. Well, let me tell you something. When I am president of the United States, and when Congress passes a law to restore those freedoms, I will sign it into law.
That's all the Supreme Court said. Yeah, she's not playing around. That's what the Supreme Court said. You want to make the law, then make the law. You can't have the court rule on it. I don't understand the problem. I really don't. It's infuriating, the lies. They are corrupt. Now, she's had these strong Supreme Court feelings for a long time. When Harris first ran for president in 2019, she told Politico that when it comes into reining in the Supreme Court, quote, everything is on the table to do that. I mean, why? I mean, it's only lasted 250 years. It's been fine. But let's change it up now because it's an emergency. Biden and Harris have plenty of backup on the left. You'll understand more later on in the program. But let's just start here with AOC. She recently initiated impeachment proceedings against Supreme Court Justices Clarence Thomas and Samuel Alito. Just for grins, let's listen in.
Justices Thomas and Alito's years-long pattern of misconduct and failure to recuse in cases bearing their clear personal and financial involvement represents an abuse of power and threat to our democracy fundamentally incompatible with continued service on our nation's highest court. For the good of the institution and the nation, absent resignation, they must be removed.
You know, it's times like this that I wonder if I know too much. Maybe knowing too much is a bad thing, because I keep thinking of episode number 5 of the Beck story. You've got to listen to that. You will not be able to take what she just said. Knowing what you will know after that episode, you will not, your head will explode. Now, Senators Sheldon Whitehouse of Rhode Island and Ron Wyden of Oregon also recently submitted a letter to Attorney General Merrick Garland, who's oh so fair, requesting that he appoint a special counsel to investigate Clarence Thomas for alleged ethics violations. Now, there were similar calls by Democrats to investigate Thomas last summer. It didn't go anywhere. And mainly because 112 of Thomas's former law clerks signed an open letter defending Thomas. Their letter said, and I quote, "As his law clerks, we offer this response. Different paths led us to our year with Justice Thomas, and we have followed different paths since. But along the way, we all saw something with our own eyes, and it was the same thing. His integrity is impeachable." I got to tell you, I think Donald Trump and Clarence Thomas, they're the two most persecuted, politically persecuted people maybe in our history. The attacks are nothing new. Democrats have been trying to destroy Clarence Thomas since he was first nominated in court in 1991. What's different about the attacks now and the attacks on the Supreme Court in general are summed up by the Thomas clerks in another quote from their letter. Here it is, quote, "These attacks against Thomas are part of a larger attack on the court and its legitimacy as an institution. The picture they paint of the court and the man for whom we worked bear no resemblance to reality." This is what we have to try to get across to our family and our friends. And honestly, I don't know how to do it. I did it with one member of my family this summer. I sat down and I said, no, that's not what it says. Here, let me look up for you. Now, I don't know her mind. We had a great conversation. What you're hearing in the news is not true. What these people are saying is not true. So what has Democrats so up in arms on the Supreme Court this summer? Well, it's a string of decisions at the very end of the latest term, mostly decided by the court's conservative wing, especially their ruling on presidential immunity. Now, when you're talking presidential immunity, know that what you do in office, if he starts a war and somebody says that was, you know, a war against humanity, you don't want to have to try your president. So sovereignty does, official acts, if they're constitutional, need to be protected. Other than that, no. Now, keep in mind that the majority decision on that case was written by Chief Justice John Roberts, who isn't exactly, you know, the paragon of conservative hawks. The justices determined by a 6-3 vote that presidents have immunity from prosecution for official acts in office. But other unofficial acts are not immune from prosecution. As it pertains to Donald Trump, this decision means that some of the charges against him now go back to a lower court to determine exactly which ones may be prosecuted. In the majority opinion, Chief Justice Roberts said, and I quote, "The president is not above the law, but under our system of separated powers, very important, the president may not be prosecuted for exercising his core constitutional powers, and he is entitled to at least presumptive immunity from prosecution for his official acts. That immunity applies equally to all occupants of the Oval Office." Now, naturally, left-wing politicians and media decide that that meant the end of democracy. Listen to this freak out from Joy Reid. It pretty much says it all.
Presumably, if he were to use SEAL Team 6 to try to assassinate one of his political opponents, so long as he did it through the auspices of the presidency, let's say use the NSA to say, let me investigate the Bidens as a national security threat. And then we need to go ahead and assassinate them when they take a foreign trip. We'll just go ahead and use drones to assassinate them, let's say, in a foreign country. He can do anything. When you're president, they let
that
you do it.
That is not true.
That's what they just ruled today. This is DEFCON 1, friends. They are trying to repeal the entire 20th century, and they're doing it fast.
I don't even know. I mean, let's just look at her example. Let's say he used the NSA and said, hey, I want you to investigate my political opponent on this. Well, that's what Hillary Clinton and Joe Biden did to Donald Trump. And it was all on bogus stuff that we now know they knew was bogus stuff. So they've already violated that. And then let's have him assassinated. How do you think that is a constitutional power of the president of the United States to have his political foe assassinated? And by the way, that hits a little close to home right now, quite honestly. Then there's always the delightful California Congresswoman Nancy Pelosi, who said this.
Do you have confidence in the Supreme Court?
No, I think they've gone rogue. It's most unfortunate, but it's unfortunate further to see what the other justice, what happened to the Chief Justice? Did he go weak or did he go rogue? I don't know. So no, I don't have confidence in the Supreme Court. I think that some of the decisions they've, see, I respect their point of view. If they have a point of view about a woman's right to choose, okay, but that's not what they're there to do, to advocate for a point of view, run for Congress. They're there to uphold the Constitution of the United States.
That is the point the Supreme Court made in that decision. We have our own point of view, but we should not exercise our points of view on the American people. Only the American people can make that decision. What part of this is not understood by a kindergartner? All of this hyperbole stems from the hysterics written by Justice Sonia Sotomayor in her dissenting opinion. Quote, "The president of the United States is the most powerful person in the country and possibly the world. When he uses his official powers in any way under the majority's reasoning, he can now be insulated from criminal prosecution." No. Order the Navy SEAL Team 6 to assassinate a political rival? Immune. No, he's not. Organizes a military coup to hold on to power? Immune. No, he's not. Takes a bribe in exchange for a pardon? Immune, 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 immune. That is not true. If you only knew who this justice really was. And then she ends dramatically by saying, and I quote, "With fear for our democracy, I dissent. Justice Sotomayor, we are not a democracy, and that is important. And if somebody like you doesn't know the difference, maybe you shouldn't be there." Chief Justice Roberts writes that the dissent, quote, "strike a tone of chilling doom that is wholly disproportionate to what the court actually does today." Do you think these guys want people to assassinate each other? You're out of your mind. But never mind that, of course, mad at all.
I mean, this is a death squad ruling. This is a ruling that says that as long as you can construe it as an official or quasi-official act, you can do absolutely anything. Absolutely anything.
Okay, first of all, if that was true, we have impeachment power to punish a president for doing illegal things. But we don't have to go there because that's not true. And if you had a political opponent assassinated or thrown in jail because you illegally investigated him using the NSA, which you did, I don't know the country would stand for it. So, but they have to keep pumping out these lies when they're, you know, when it suits their agenda, which is right now, because they have to tear down the Supreme Court so they can give it an extreme makeover, so they can do whatever they want as a president. This is coming from Joe Biden. This is coming from Joe Biden because they wouldn't allow him to do things like, hey, free college for everybody. That has to go through the House. Voted on by Congress, then signed by him. And then the Supreme Court can say, that's not constitutional. You're going to have to find another way to do that. But you cannot just have the president write checks. He rolls out in front of the cameras to say a bunch of the same lies.
For all practical purposes, today's decision almost certainly means that there are virtually no limits on what a president can do.
This is so ridiculous. And I have a really hard time giving people the benefit of the doubt in this position, especially the news anchors, because they know better. But I don't know how to tell you to talk to your friends about this, but this is so important. Of course, there are limits on what the president can do. The Supreme Court ruling clearly states, have a copy of this for your friends, that a president cannot be persecuted for duties carried out under his constitutional authority. Killing an opponent is not covered with constitutional authority. But actions outside the authority are able to prosecute. Oh, okay. Listen to this.
It's a dangerous precedent because the power of the office will no longer be constrained by the law, even including the Supreme Court of the United States. The only limits will be self-imposed by the president alone.
Nothing in the decision allows the president to define official and unofficial actions to keep himself out of legal trouble. Nothing. Next, Biden got around to attacking the credibility of the court.
This decision today has continued the court's attack in recent years on a wide range of long-established legal principles in our nation. From gutting voting rights and civil rights, to taking away a woman's right to choose, to today's decision that undermines the rule of law
May
of this
I just
nation.
Ask, when did the Supreme Court gut voting rights? Because I didn't see that one. I also didn't see when they gutted civil rights. Must have missed those two. Of course, not only can every U.S. citizen over 18 vote in some Democrat-controlled cities, including San Francisco, New York, and even non-citizens can vote there in local elections. So spare me the voting and civil rights lies. The taking away of a woman's right to choose is also a convenient lie. The Supreme Court merely said there is no constitutional right to kill an unborn baby. But states, locals, can decide for themselves. They can determine their own abortion rules. Abortion has gone up since Roe versus Wade. Your ability to kill your unborn baby, you can rest assured you can kill your baby anytime in some states. Congratulations. That remains fully intact.
I know I will respect the limits of the presidential powers I have for 3.5 years.
Oh, my God.
But any president, including Donald Trump, will now be free to ignore the law.
Okay. Joe Biden has respected the limits of presidential power? Really? Since when? What about the single-handedly forgiving billions of dollars in student loan debt? The Supreme Court had to strike it down twice. His first pass, they struck it down. Then he did it again through executive order. They struck it. You can't do that. And he's doing it anyway. Really? How about the COVID vaccine mandate or the eviction moratorium? This is obviously not what America needs from any president. What America needs is to go back to the constitutional principles that got us to be a great country. Supreme Court is limiting the government's power. That's what they're doing, limiting the administrative state. The more glaring problem here is the growing movement on the left to tear down the Supreme Court.
I concur with Justice Sotomayor's dissent today. Here's what she said. She said, in every use of official power, the president is now a king above the law. With fear for our democracy, I dissent. End of quote. So should the American people dissent. I dissent.
The radical left views the Supreme Court as an obstacle when it doesn't advance their agenda. You never heard a problem with the Supreme Court. Conservatives just go ahead and try to change the mind of the Supreme Court. We don't change the Supreme Court when we lose, but that is the way that things run under this mimocracy. It has advanced the left-wing agenda, the Supreme Court has, more often than not over the past half century. Progressivism brought us activism into the courts. Please listen to episode number 5, where enlightened judges read into the law the policies that they wanted. So this new, really unprecedented veering back towards real constitutionalism has the left in a raging panic mode because they know they can't do these things by vote because you're not for them.